Let's go. They whole team get ran through. Ain't one thing I can't do. Snakes and grass, no bamboo. Move on quick, I plan to. On the fence, don't stand you. Cloud my eyes, no land you. Don't take L's, they hand you. Plan ain't throw no time for plans. They whole team get ran through. Ain't one thing I can't do. Snakes and grass, no bamboo. Move on quick, I plan to. On the fence, don't stand you. Cloud my eyes, no land you. Don't take L's, they hand you. Plan ain't go no time for plan to.
Don't let any of those things get away, Morty.
And be sure to keep the garage door open while these things scurry about. That seems to propel a lot of our plots.
One sin into this episode, and we're already pretending that this satirical cartoon should be taken at face value. This is gonna be a long one, isn't it?
Also, is this a garden hose hanging on the side of the Smith house? That thing is huge. That is the girthiest yard hose ever to hose a yard. Can we call it Dirt Diggler?
Everything wrong with Rick and Morty, ladies and gentlemen. The Smith family has a big hose.
I, Morty Smith, invoke my right to choose one in every 10 Rick and Morty adventures.
So it's true, Rick and Morty have adventures that are not televised, so it's possible we haven't seen other adventures chosen by Morty. But the episode Me Seeks and Destroy seemingly established that Morty would choose at least one adventure in every 10 episode season. When Morty angled to be in charge of every third adventure, and Rick casually rebutted him off with every 10th, this self-aware show was surely referring to the number of episodes in a season. I think they just forgot this was a thing until now.
Or maybe, and hear me out, because I'm about to explain the meaning of life and the universe, maybe all of the completely random assumptions you just pulled out of your ass are not true?
This time travel box hasn't paid off, and I'm calling it. It's been long enough. I want some time travel shenanigans, damn it. This container has been teasing me since episode one, and my flux is at full capacitor.
Do you honestly not realize that what you just complained about is literally the point? The reason the time travel box is here is to mock the sci-fi time travel trope. What you're saying in this sin is that this episode is making a mistake for having a meta joke.
They did a whole Vindicators without us. Bunch of them got killed, too.
So Morty is an unabashed Vindicators fan, and while it makes sense that they would do an adventure without Rick and Morty, it seems like he would have figured that out already, since he's such a huge fan of them and all. Wouldn't he have various news feeds set up to follow whatever the Vindicators were doing, even when they weren't assembled?
It's entirely possible that the Vindicators did their previous mission without it ending up on the news, as this scene right here is implying.
Yikes. Yeah, things did feel less diverse in there.
Sure, there's a white guy, but there's also a woman who is apparently a solar system, a person made of ants, a robot crocodile, and a ghost train conductor of color. What the hell is Rick even talking about?
He's talking about the lack of diversity? Notice how he said less diverse, implying that there was still diversity in the group, but simply less than there was before. He never said that it wasn't diverse at all.
I'll buy that Supernova and Vance can fly down from the jet. And I guess maybe Million Ants can somehow float down with Morty in tow, but how do Alan Rails and Crocubot even come close to surviving the impact of that height?
He's asking how a person with superpowers and an alligator with cybernetic enhancements could survive a relatively short fall. What's your IQ? You know, for research purposes.
Are you alright?
Yes. I only lost 400 ants.
Million ants is made up of a million ants. This many bullet holes would have caused the slaughter of well into the tens of thousands.
And your evidence? Can you show us your work? Because you're just making this claim without providing any actual proof, so we have no reason to believe that what you're saying is true, especially when we take your somewhat less than impressive track record into account.
My queen is laying more. I am back to 1 million ants.
Literal Ant-Man could have had any kind of biology and it would make sense, I suppose. I mean, this guy's made up of ants. But don't ants have to go through the larvae and pupae stages before developing into full-blown ants? This whole process lasts a month at least. So even if your queen could somehow spit them out that fast, your chronology needs some work.
Or maybe, just maybe, this sci-fi cartoon with a character who is literally made out of ants is suggesting that the ants aren't the same species as the ones we have in our real world, and therefore don't have all the same properties.
Geez, Supernova. I mean, there's unrealistic body image, and then there is a toilet paper roll balancing two cantaloupes while sitting on top of the Great Pumpkin. Is your superpower transmitting body dysmorphia?
Everything wrong with Vindicators 3, ladies and gentlemen. Jeremy has a boner for Supernova.
We're taking fire from an automated turret. Can you bring it offline?
Seems like they wouldn't need Rick to do this, since many of the superheroes have powers that could easily destroy the turret on their own. But this episode is a parody of superhero movies, so maybe that's the point. I'm sending it anyway, because I won't feel right in the morning if I don't.
Admits that this episode is a parody, sends it anyway. That's what we call stupidity, boys and girls.
Do it in 3 minutes or you'll die.
So at what point does Rick transition from hilarious, nihilistic asshole to legitimate supervillain? Has he always been the villain of the show? Look, that's fine if that's the case. I'm just saying at some point we need some sort of moral foundation here, right?
So the sin is that Rick isn't a good person? What? Why is that a mistake of the episode? Are you expecting all the characters to be perfect people? How much stupidity is too much stupidity?
This is triggering me. I need space.
Does anyone even want to just glance at the board and maybe just do the easy matching game? I'm as stubborn and prideful as the next guy, but if my life's on the line, I'm at least going to check out the difficulty level before I get all flustered.
Didn't you mention how this episode is a parody of superhero movies earlier? How are you failing to understand the jokes if you know that? The episode is showing us that the Vindicators feel invincible because of their pride and arrogance, which is their downfall. It's hilarious how he claims that this channel is satirical, and yet he doesn't understand real satire when he's watching it.
Look, I know the drunk Rick set all this up, and all of this is surprising to him too. But sober Rick doesn't care one bit about these assholes. So why is he all horrified about fans? The Rick we know and love would be stoic about this and be ready with a sarcastic quip.
You are correct that he doesn't care about Vance's death. It's more the manner of the death. I mean, the dude literally got sliced and diced. It was pretty brutal.
Give me one reason why I shouldn't crush your windpipe.
Because my epidermis is laced with a nanofiber defense mesh.
Okay, that's awesome. But when he grabbed your neck, your eyeball went to bloodshot, which means your defense mesh wasn't working when he first grabbed you and appears to only exist for this joke.
Right, because this is a comedy, and it's not supposed to follow real-world logic, meaning that this is not a sin.
But they don't pick the location you'll never hear them even mention.
Oh, I know this.
Dude, this game doesn't even have a timer. Why the rush?
Pride, arrogance, satirical parody.
Even drunk Pickled Rick is a super genius, but he's just one super genius, right? How does one person build this entire fully automated giant instructional screen and an interactive holographic display in one drunken night?
Jeremy, you're watching a cartoon about a mad scientist who created a gun that can portal between dimensions. If he can do shit like that, then he can do shit like this.
Drunk version of me is probably so supportive of Israel. He wants what's best for it, and—
Hey man, I'm not touching this.
That's a funny reply, but does Million Ants know the geopolitical complexity of issues concerning Israel to the point that he knows it's a touchy subject?
Yes, because he just said something that proves he does? Why did you ask a question that was answered literally seconds ago? Also, Jeremy sends something he likes cliche.
Say, you have to hit 5 3-pointers in 5 minutes or, I don't know, the whole place, the whole planet will get blown up with a neutrino bomb.
Rick clearly recorded his audio first, making it up as he went, and then had to enact his ramblings into the real world. Which is kind of brilliant, considering that's basically how this show seems to be created. So this is either a sin for Rick standing in as the proxy for the writer's laziness, or a sin for being brilliant enough to get away with it. Either way.
Can you explain how the writers are being lazy with this formula? How is it lazy to record audio first and then make everything else up? You can't just say words and expect them to be true without any logic behind it. Also, the two options he gave at the end there are both not sins, so another one feels appropriate.
Another one.
I'll disarm the drunkenly improvised neutrino bomb.
Morty, how many of these?
Too many, Rick! Too many!
Okay, so he's disarmed a few of these bombs, but why the hell is he all of a sudden going full Hurt Locker when we all know non-drunk Rick is the one that will eventually take care of this?
Because he doesn't know that Rick will take care of it? Do you think that the characters within the show are supposed to know what the audience knows? There's this thing called dramatic irony, and as a so-called movie and TV critic, you should really know what that is. Also, Jeremy makes a pop culture reference that isn't a sin of the episode cliche.
Is there something set up on this basketball court that detects the distance from which these guys shoot the basket? Because it seems like they could just shoot layups and everything rigged up here wouldn't know the difference. I mean, if it allows Supernova to cheat the three-pointers like this, then there's nothing stopping them from taking the easiest shot possible.
And why is that a sin? The episode makes it clear to us that Rick kinda just stopped putting effort into it when he got to this particular trap, so it actually makes sense that he wouldn't have bothered to do anything about that.
Morty gets on the platform and it works, but we find out that drunk Rick was thinking of Noob Noob as the answer to this question. And while this game might just be total bullshit, and that's exactly the point of it all, this whole thing is so detailed you'd think if drunk Rick was really thinking about Noob Noob, he'd have made sure the platform required Noob Noob.
It's entirely possible that either A, your explanation about it not mattering is the case and therefore it's not a sin, or B, the platform is based on the weight of the person who steps onto it and therefore it's not a sin. Either way, it's not a sin.
Every single puzzle Rick set up was accompanied by a video, and every single one of these recordings took place in his garage. And while he may not have had every game planned, he clearly had the last game planned because he had already cut out the rainbow background for the last video message. But that last one was recorded somewhere in the cave they're currently in. So why did he wait to do this one here when he did all the other videos in his garage?
I don't know. Maybe he was just really drunk and acting insane because of it. Have you never been drunk? Cause drunk people love doing stupid and unnecessary shit.
You were always the romantic. Which is why you can't leave either.
So Supernova is a full-blown psychopath now? Just like that. Was there any sign of this over her years of service? This is a sin for the Vindicator's HR department, if nothing else.
So you're complaining about not seeing a history of instability in a character we just met at the beginning of this episode? Do you hear yourself when you talk?
I'm going to enjoy this.
And let's give a huge thanks to Rick Sanchez for—
Wouldn't all the people up here have seen Supernova doing all the evil she did, including killing million ants while they took the ride on the elevator? You mean nobody was looking down during that whole thing? And what about the superheroes? Nobody looked up and saw tons of people up there having a party?
How many people do you honestly think would walk up to the edge of a big crater and look down just to be able to see an elevator coming up towards them? What the fuck? Also, none of the people on the elevator saw the people up top because they can't see through the ground. As long as the people aren't floating above the pit, they wouldn't have any kind of visual angle.
And for booking one of the hottest talents out there, logic!
I mean, there's logic problems, and then there's logic problems. Apparently this episode has both.
And you have a whole lot of unfunny jokes and stupid mistakes in every single one of your videos, but I'm still struggling to understand your point.
With great power comes the absolute certainty that you'll turn into a right cunt.